just want to give God thanks for his faithfulness. And as I said, I would ask and bid your prayers for our family and for Sister Pastor and I, that the will of the Lord will be done. It's been a very stressful week in the sense that it's been one difficulty after another. But I want to assure you this morning, I know my God will make a way.
Amen.
I'm convinced of that. I have peace. My wife has peace. My family has peace. And we're blessed, but we still covet your prayers. That the perfect will of the Lord will be done. And so we thank you for your kindness, your prayers, your love, and concern for us. But I want to speak today on a subject that I feel like will be an encouragement to you.
Oh, Jesus.
And will be a great strength to you. Before I do, I want to say thank you to the Lord for my precious niece back there, Stacy. She's with us in service today. God bless her. The Lord has his hand upon her precious life.
Yes.
And it's just good to see you, sweetheart. God bless you. I want to talk to you today about angels. And about the impact of angels breaking the demonic activity in the life of the believer. And how that God has his hand upon your life. And because he has his hand upon your life, we all have angels as God's people encamped around about us. And I don't know their names. I don't know. We know Gabriel and Michael in the Bible. We know that there's strong warring angels. There's angels to do ministering spirits to the church. I do know this, in these days that we're living in, the angels of the Lord are very active. The fallen angels are active. The demonic angels that fell with Lucifer in the beginning of time, they're also active. We're living in a time today that there's a strain and there's a confinement and a restrainment in the air. And it's in every facet of life. It's everywhere you go, whether it's in the White House or your house. There is a confinement. God did not design us as God's people to be confined or to be constrained. God designed us as God's people to flourish and to prosper, to be in good health, to multiply, to receive additions from things from heaven above into our lives. God didn't design us to stay and didn't have the status quo, to be immobilized, not to be immobilized. He designed us to be mobilized. And I feel God as I say this morning, because you know God's design upon your life is to excel. It's to excel to such an extent that you actually grow in Christ. And you grow, really, you grow at your own rate, because, you know, Jesus said, "You take my yoke upon you, learn of me." And that means that you have the privilege to grow at your own rate. If you want to go after God with all of your heart, I mean, day by day, every minute of the day, and cry out to the living God by faith, you're going to grow a lot faster. But if you take your time at it and just do it occasionally, you're still going to grow, but you're going to grow slower in Christ. If I can encourage you this morning and say something to you this morning that I think would be an encouragement to you, I would give you advice, and I would say, go after God with all your might. Go after the Lord with everything in you, every fiber of your being. Go after God and his will and purpose and plan for your life and your family's life. Go after the Lord in faith. Go after him. Your main, our main focus is to pursue God and to pursue his will and his thoughts for our lives. And of course, that's found in the Word of God. One of the ways that God helps us excel in this life is by the angels of the Lord that have been encamped around about us that God has sent to this earth. They're here. And I want to help you this morning that sometime in your life with the Lord, and preferably soon, you will have a divine encounter with the holy angel of heaven. You'll have that encounter. And you'll sense the work and the handiwork of the angels of God in your life, because they've been sent by the Lord to advance you. And they have been sent by the Lord to enable you. And they've been sent by the Lord to bring your request, your prayers, to the Father. That the Father would grant those requests to you. Amen. In case you don't know it this morning, which I pray and believe that you do, you can really have a talk with God, and He can have a talk with you.
Right.
You can have a conversation with the Lord, an intelligent conversation with the Lord, and He will have a conversation with you. He will speak. God can speak to you. He can speak to me, thank God. You know, that humbles me that He can actually speak to a person like me. I've seen a lot of pain and hurt in my life, but I've also hurt people in my life before I gave my life to Jesus. And I know I hurt them by the activity and the things that I were doing with my life. But I want to tell you, that's gone. That's wiped away. That's not going to inhibit me anymore. That's not going to bother me anymore. It's over. They've been washed. I've been washed in the blood. You've been washed. And your sins have been forgiven. Satan reminds you of your past. You remind him of his future. I said, if Satan reminds you of your past, you remind him of his future. God, I say it, God never consults your past to determine your future. Never. If your past comes back up, whispers in your ear, and gets you feeding in the mummy grubs and gets you down, you've got to know that's from the devil. It's not from God. And Satan's trying to confine you, and he's trying to isolate you and make you think nobody's for you and with you. Well, the devil is a liar. He's a little bitty devil, but God's a great big God. I said the devil is a little bitty devil, but God is a great big God.
Amen.
Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 1, verse 10 through 14. The words are going to be on the screen for you, that you can see them on the screen as well as hear me speak them. I never like to preach anything or speak anything about God unless I have two or three or more scriptures that agree together, that you'll know these words are not just coming from my lips and trying to manipulate you in any way, because I wouldn't do that if I knew how to do it. I don't even know how to spell manipulate. Amen? But I want you to hear these words and take them into your heart, into your spirit, so that they too can change your life. And here's what the Bible says: and thou, Lord, in the beginning hast laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the works of your hand. They shall perish, but thou remainest, and they shall wax old as doeth a garment. And as vesture shall they fold them up, and they shall be changed. Well, thou art the same. Somebody say that. He's the same. Never changes. And the years shall not fail or not fall. But to which of the angels said he at any time, sit on my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool? Listen to this. I want you to hear this. This is about the angels of the Lord that are concerned about your welfare and your life with the Father. Are they? Now, who are they? Angels. Are they not ministering spirits sent forth to minister for them who shall be heirs of salvation? Thank you for looking to the word of the Lord this morning with me. The Lord bless you. I want to ask you a question. Are you an heir of salvation?
Yes.
Have you been born again?
Yes.
Have you been washed? Glory to God. Now I can go off on a tangent right there. Man, I can forget about my notes and everything. I'm telling you, it's okay to feel God. I said it's okay to feel God.
Amen.
You know, I didn't pay nothing for that. Not a thing. Oh, glory. Let me get a minute to get my composure here, okay?
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
I don't think it's an accident when you sense God's presence. I think it's the Lord putting His seal upon what He wants to say. I really do. So let that sink in just for a moment. God really wants the heavens to be open for you. Have you ever been in your life when your prayers seem like they're falling to the ground? Where you pray something and you just pray with all your heart and you say in the name of Jesus, you say the blood of Jesus is making this happen, and you use all of the terms that you should use as a follower of Christ. You bind the devil and you loose the power of God and you believe God and you come before Him in prayer and you make your confession. That's one area that I think we need to work on more as a child of God is our verbal confession. Out loud. I'm more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. Yes, amen. Then the devices that you have devised against me will not prosper. Amen. The strategies, devil, that you, and you are the prince of the power of the air, but the strategies that you have devised against me as a child of God are defeated in the name of Jesus. Amen. I think we need to make those kind of confessions so that we understand and the devil understands he cannot confine us. Yeah. He cannot hurt us. He cannot harm us. He is defeated. He is defeated and he knows his days are short. I said the devil knows his days are short. And the Lord wants you to have an open heaven. He wants you to have a heaven where you pray while the words are still in your mouth. You get your prayers answered. I mean, right when you're in the middle of the prayer, you can get a phone call and whoever's on the other line has been sent by the Lord. And you get a relief and you get a breakthrough in your prayer. But there are times that you pray. There's times that I pray that it seems like my prayers are not getting through. There's a brass heaven. The Bible talks about brass heavens where, you know, brass is a metal that's dense. It's not as hard as iron, but it's dense. It kind of... Brass is something that it hits. You know, you can take it, hit it with a hammer, and it leaves an impression. But you still don't get through it. God wants those brass heavens to be broken, split, right in two, so that your prayers can get to God. God really does want to speak to you. And He wants to prosper you, and He wants to bless you. So when the heavens become brass, what it is, God can break through that through the power of the Holy Spirit as the angels of the Lord give you access. I don't know if you know this or not, but angels have access to God. Two. Jesus, when He talked to Bartholomew in the Bible, one of His disciples, Bartholomew came up to Jesus and said, I've seen the angels of the Lord descending, ascending and descending into the heavens upon you, Jesus. When Jesus was baptized in water in the River Jordan, and the Bible says when He came up out of the water, the Spirit of God descended upon Him like a dove. The power of God descended. Jesus turned to Bartholomew and Nathanael, and he said to him, you also shall have the angels of the Lord dispatched to you. And he brought him into remembrance of how Jacob in the Old Testament, the Bible talked about how Jacob, when he climbed a ladder, and he saw the angels ascending and descending. Notice that it's not descending first, it's ascending first. According to your faith and my trust in the Lord. We cry unto the Lord and He hears our prayer. Sometimes all we can say is, "Help, Jesus, help." We don't even know what to pray. He said, "My people, when they call unto me, I'll hear their cry and I will deliver them out of all." But he was praying. He was concerned about the people of God. He was concerned about the welfare of the nation. He was concerned about the people of God. And how many know we need to be concerned about the people of God? We need to be concerned about one another. Amen.
Amen.
The Bible says, then he said unto me, fear not, Daniel. Daniel prayed in his concern. And the angel of the Lord came to Daniel after he had prayed and said these words. Then said he unto me, fear not, Daniel, for from the first day that thou didst set your heart to understand and to chasten yourself or humble yourself before your God. How many know this morning that it's imperative that we humble ourselves before God?
Hallelujah.
Because we can't do this ourselves. How many times have we tried to do something ourselves and think our way through something and try to get ourselves out of a mess and it just gets worse? Are you with me, church? You hear me? It just gets worse. I've done it myself. And then I go, well, Lord, why didn't I just give that to you in the first place and just let you have it, humble myself and say, I messed up. I messed up and I'm still messed up. It takes a man or woman of God to do that now, because some people have a hard time with admitting they were wrong. I don't. I'm going to tell you, I don't. And I'd like you to have some of I don't in your life. I don't. I don't have a problem with it. If I miss it and I'm wrong, I'll be the first one to tell you. I'll tell the whole church. I missed it. The Bible says that Daniel humbled himself before his God. He set his heart to hear from God. He set his heart to hear from the things of God. And here's what the Bible says. And he said, chasten yourself before your God. The words were heard. And I have come for your words. Oh my goodness. Oh, ain't nobody can tell me that God doesn't want to talk to me and hear what I've got to say. He heard Daniel's words. He heard the words he was putting in the atmosphere and the communication that Daniel was trying to engage in Almighty God according and for the affairs of those that were around about him. He was crying out to God, oh God, help. Oh God, send your direction. Send your strength. Send your answer. How many believe this morning that God can answer?
Amen.
And then he said, but the prince, listen, you're not going to be able to make it as a child of God until you learn, number one, that God's on your side. Number two, that you have an adversary. We can't just sit back and let everything that comes down the pike and hits our lives and just sit back and go, oh, someday it's going to get better. I'll tell you what, you're going to have to learn to fight. You say, I'm a lover, not a fighter. Well, be both. Learn to fight. Bible talks about fighting the good fight of faith. Fight. God's given us power to bind on earth what is already bound in heaven. Bind. Take authority in Jesus' name and bind the devil. Bind him. And loose the power of God. He's given us power to bind and to loose. Don't forget to loose the power of God after you bind. That's your confession. After you mess up the devil with your words from the Word of God, you mess the devil up, then loose the power of God on his head. Loose the power of God on your condition. Loose the power of God in your situation. Loose it.
Yes.
Loose it by saying, my God has paid the price through Jesus Christ. And in the name of Jesus, I have the victory. I mean, loose it. And then walk, square your shoulders back. My God, I got some big shoulders. I square them back, Bill. Square them back, my God. I'm a little man, but don't mess with me, devil. Because greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Square them shoulders back, and you walk through life. And you, when you walk through life, go, I'm not the tail, I'm the head. I'm not the tail. I don't got no curse, but you talking about, devil. I ain't got no curse. curses on me. I'm favored of God. The hand of God's on me. You're not being prideful when you do that. You're being smart. You're being smart. Daniel prays, and the Bible says, the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 1 in 20 days, but lo, Michael, archangel of the Lord, one of the chief princes, came to help me. We've already found two places in the Bible that angels are ministering spirits to them that are heirs of salvation. Now we see another place in the Bible where the angels want to help. Listen, I'm praying right now, and I'm prophesying to you right now that the angels that are dispatched to you, God's going to open up your eyes and you're going to see the results of what angels can do in your life. You're going to look back and go, how'd that happen? I want to tell you something. I believe it's going to be an angel of the Lord that's sent by God to be an heir for your salvation. And it's going to be sent by God to do some things, and you're going to see some manifestations of what they can do. I've seen them more than once in my life. In times of hard situations, where there was no way out, a man pulled a knife on me one time. He said, I'm going to cut your belly open. The preacher was with me. He said, in the name of Jesus, Jesus loves you, sir. And I watched an angel of the Lord grab the man's hand and put it down to his side. He grumbled and walked away and didn't touch my body. God opened my eyes. I was 1 week old. 1 week. Would you like to have a knife pulled on you? He was only 5, 7 days old in Jesus Christ. Just got born again. You know what's going through my mind? I'm checking out. I'm going to go to be with Jesus. But that big preacher that was with me knew better. He knew better. He knew love turns away wrath. He knew Proverbs 15:1 where it says a soft answer turns away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger. You can't fight the devil on your terms, sir, ma'am. But you can fight him through what the word says. You can fight the devil. And you will win. Every time. He said this angel that was sent from the prince of Persia was sent for 20 days, 21 days. The Bible says your prayers were hindered. He said, I've sent Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me and to remain there with me with the kings of Persia. Is there one more verse for that? Or did I just give you 13?
Just give me 13, but I'll give you that.
Okay, that's it. Thank you. Now I've come to make thee understand what shall fall to thy people. Point here this morning is this. If you engage, and if I engage to go after God, pursue God, you're going to get a God response. How many want a God response? How many are tired of hearing the lies of the devil? And you want to hear God speak to you and raise you up and do some mighty things through your life? Then let me encourage you. Engage. Take a stand and listen to me. Please listen to me. There's going to be people that's not going to understand when you engage. You're going to engage and you're going to start pursuing God, and the flaky kind of people that are around you, the flaky kind of people that are just interested in the horizontal realm, they're going to just kind of, where are you coming from? What's going on with you? And you're going to go after God with such fervency and such desire, and you're going to see prayers answered, and you're going to try to tell other people that may just be lax before God, and they're not going to understand the thing you're saying. But then you're going to tell some people, and they're going to go, oh my God, pray with me. Believe with me. Let's pray together. Let's believe God. For 21 days, Daniel's prayers were being hindered by a devil out of the pit of hell. But God, the first day, sent a warring angel to fight for Daniel and to fight for the prayer. Don't stop praying. Don't stop believing. Stop! Keep praying! If your babies need salvation, Because there's a warring angel about ready to take the arm of the devil and jerk it off of your situation.
That's right.
He ain't going to slap his wrist, friend. The angels of the Lord are going to handcuff the devil and chain him somewhere. And listen to me. Once you make a victory like that, once your faith gets strong to where you've got a victory and you know you've got a victory, listen, you'll be able to take the strategies of the devil and mess them up before they even get to fruition. It won't be after the fact, it'll be before the fact. You will keep things from happening that could happen if we keep lingering in this neutral ground. Listen, as a child of God, you need to say, man, I'm going forward. I'm going forward, man. Ain't no none of this backward stuff and none of this neutral. I did, you know, it's just going to work out and everything. No. God, I'm standing up to the plate. I believe in God. No matter what news you hear from the gainsayers, people say you can't do that. I've had friends in my life that come to me and said, preacher, you think I want to do this? Listen, anything the hand of God is on, he will bless. If God's spoken to you and if God's speaking to you, you can expect the blessing of God to follow. Sadness hits your house. If your children are sad, there's pain in their little lives. Mama, if you're a child of God, you walk through your house or your room or wherever you stay, wherever it is that you abide, and you walk through that place and you say in the name of Jesus, my babies will do exploits, my babies will do great things, my babies will be entrepreneurs, my babies will do mighty things for the kingdom of God and for the work of God. I don't care what it was. I'm talking about a God that is right now and can change it. No, I'm not sorry. I'm not. Because we've watched, me and that little lady back there, we've watched the hand of God in impossible odds in our lives. We've watched the hand of God move in and do something that could not be done except God send his angel to get it done. Sometimes we just need help. To go to a courtroom tomorrow to defend someone we love. Listen, I'm not going to be back in that courtroom going, I'm going to be in that courtroom praying. Hey, somebody you love, you need to be praying. If you're filled with the Holy Ghost, you need to pray in the Holy Ghost. Because you're praying in the will of God, you need to be praying. I'm going to be in there praying. Now, I'm not going to pray out loud so everybody can hear me. I'm not there to show them I can pray. But under my breath, I'm going to be praying. Doing a lot of praying, my tongue is going to be moving. Listen to me. I need to say this. It wasn't in my notes, but I need to say it. Every tongue that has risen up against you in judgment, God himself shall condemn. No weapon that is formed against you shall prosper. Every tongue that has risen up against you in judgment, God himself shall condemn, because their salvation and their heritage is of me, saith the Lord. I needed to say that today. Every tongue, every word that's been spoken that you can't, it won't work, and God's not touching your life, and it's not going to happen. Every thought that says I can't do it is coming down right now in the name of Jesus. It's coming down and it's stronger than the ground. Sir, the hand of God is upon you. I've never seen you in my life. There's something God has for you, son. Don't ever think you can't do it. You're qualified. God says you're qualified. Glory to God. Daniel kept praying. And God used that man to save the entire nation from demise. Sometimes I think we don't realize that our prayers are so important. Not only for our behalf, but for the behalf of those that are around about us. And I, for one, this morning will tell you, when you walk with God, you humble yourself before the Lord, the heavens will be open. Deuteronomy. Another scripture I want to give you. And the heavens that are over your head shall be brass, and the earth is under you shall be iron. In other words, it's a hard place. Iron represents a real difficult, hard place. Iron. I had a piece of iron fall on my foot here a while back, and I had good boots on it. But I could feel the hurt, the pain that iron is hitting. Iron represents things of the devil. I'm not against iron. You drive iron in your bed. Brass, the iron under our feet. In other words, the way of our life is hard. I want to tell you something. The Bible says the way of the transgressor is hard. I'm not a transgressor. I'm on the Lord's side now. I said I'm on the Lord's side now. I want to tell you something. There's going to be people. You just mark this down. Please do. I encourage you to do it. I encourage you to get the CD because you're going to want to remember this. There's going to be people that's going to fight the Holy Ghost that's working in your life. You got somebody that's going to come by and they're going to say, there's no business for that thing called the Holy Ghost. Speaking in tongues is of the devil. They're going to say it. That's not in the Bible. You're going to hear people speak things against the Holy Ghost. The Bible said in the book of Acts that if a man or a person fights against the work of the Holy Ghost and that pertains to the life of the believer, they're fighting against God. Jesus died on the cross, not just to give you eternal life, but he died on the cross that the Comforter would come. Yeah. The Comforter would come and he would live inside of you and the power of God would manifest through your life. That's why Jesus died. He didn't die and leave you here alone. He sent another Comforter. He sent the power that represents all heaven, and he's called the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost. Tell you something. It grieves me when I hear people talk about the manifest power of the Holy Ghost. It grieves me. Because without the Holy Spirit making things happen on behalf of the believer, we don't have anything. We can't do it with our own abilities and our own smarts. I know we've got a lot of smart people here, a lot of smart people watching the television. I'm pretty smart myself. That doesn't matter to nothing. What matters is that the Lord gives the opportunity by the power of the Spirit of God to work on our behalf. I can't do this. I can't look in the eyes of a family that's going through literal hell and they're facing a divorce and they're facing their children are sad and hurt and in pain and they're facing a divorce. They're facing problematic situations, jail time or whatever the case may be. And I can't look at them and say, well, it's going to be all right, honey, and everything's going to work out. But I tell you what I can do. I can look at them and say, put your faith in God. Put your faith in Jesus, and he'll make a way where there seems to be no way, and he'll open doors that no man can open, and he'll do it for you. I can say that because I know I can't do it. Because if I could do it, I would go down to the jailhouse and I'd let everybody out. I'd let them all out. Then I'd take them to church. Love on them. Don't you ever think that just because somebody in your family's been incarcerated, there's no hope for them. That's a lie from the pit of hell. There's hope as long as there's breath in that human body. And as long as there is a God, and I'll tell you what, he'll be around forever. I'm going to have to close because I'm getting too long-winded. I'm going to give you some declarations and some things to confess. I want to help you with your confession. I want to help you with the authority of the believer. God has given you authority. I've watched over and over and over again how that God can take a life that's just completely devastating. Without hope. I've seen it. I've lived in a cornfield. I know what it lives, know what it means to live destitute. I've been in that place. I know what it feels like to be homeless. I know what it feels like to be abused. I know what it feels like to be rejected and dejected. And, to feel like nobody cares. I've watched so many people, but as I walked through the courthouse the other day, and hundreds of people, and I felt the pain of the people that I was looking at their little faces, and I was looking at their, I didn't know their conditions, but I could tell some of them were crying, some of them were wailing, saying, "Oh my God, I can't believe what's happened to my son and my daughter." And my heart broke. It broke so desperately that I felt I was going to die. I just felt like I'm going to die right here. I can't take this pain. I can't bear that burden. I can't. I'm feeling your pain. And the Holy Spirit lifted it from me, but told me and showed me I've come to set them free. If they will let me, son, if they will let me touch their life, if they will let me come into their life and change their life, I will set them free and I will deliver them and I will deliver their families and I will prosper them and bless them. I've watched families receive that blessing, but I've also seen families go away from that blessing, and it gets worse and worse and worse. The only direction we need to be going right now is forward. I want to help you with this confession. I'm going to read this to you. There's three of them here, and I'm going to give you 13 real quick, and I'm finished. You're going to have to get the CD or get the DVD to hear them again. Number one, God will teach you that God is not a man that he should lie.
Amen.
Number two, I'm not ignorant of who I am in Christ Jesus. Number three, I stand in victory through the blood of Jesus Christ. Through faith in Jesus Christ, I have become a seed of Abraham. The Bible says we're heirs with God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. And through the seed of Abraham, through the seed of faith, the blessings of Abraham are upon my life. Somebody said, "Well, you know, Abraham didn't, he wasn't blessed. He was the richest man in the Old Testament Bible." Don't preach riches, preach. Would you have rather have poverty or riches?
Riches.
Somebody said God hadn't called me to be financially prosperous. Oh, yes, he has. He's called you to be prosperous in every area of your life. He said, "I would to God that you would prosper and be in good health, even as your soul prospers." Your soul, if your soul, your intellect, your will, and your emotion will connect to the things of God, he will take you from where you are now and to a place where you can prosper and be blessed. He can get you a job. And an employer that you can work with, that God will give you that job and he will prosper you in the placing of you on that job. And you will promote, be promoted even above those that's been there 10 years. He will promote you. You'll advance. I don't know about you. I don't want to devance. Is there such a word? Devance? I want to advance. And you don't have to do it yourself. You just got to be available. Through faith, seed of Abraham. Oh Lord, transfer or remove all channels and changes that have been spoken against me that have ascended. Agents of the devil that are bent on stopping my advancement. Let me give you 13 real quick. I bind and render in the name of Jesus all demonic antagonism, strife, marginal success, wrong words. I don't know why the Lord gave me this, but bad feet and bad luck. I denounce it. Somebody in this room listening to me this morning, he's touching your feet.
Yes.
I believe it. All demonic opinions against me ceased to exist. Evil collaborations and strategies be gone. Demonic words and unprofitable and strange workings against me be destroyed. Unprofitable thoughts be destroyed. Confusion be destroyed. Listen to this now. This is for all of us at times. Mind blankness. Mind blankness. In other words, while you're in the heat of something and you can't speak and your mouth seems to be sewed shut, be gone. That you'll have an answer for every man that answers, that wants to answer for the hope that is in you. Your mind won't go blank. Has that ever happened to you? It's happened to me before and I don't like it. I had to go off and pray and say, God, what's wrong with me? And he said, take authority. Take authority over the blankness of your mind. Because my mind's engaged in the things of God. Mind dullness. Memory.